My best estimate at the time was more than 140 chimps, which was far more than the largest previously known community anywhere.
Why do they hunt? One old idea is that they hunt when they're hungry, when there isn't a lot of fruit around. But as things turn out, it's exactly the opposite.
The monkey gets out on a small branch and he's momentarily trying to decide what to do. Another chimpanzee comes from an adjacent tree, jumps onto the other end of the bough, runs at the monkey from behind, grabs him.
We got one.
I was standing maybe 15 feet from them, watching this. Three male chimpanzees each took an arm or a leg, and they literally started drawing and quartering this monkey. Here's a leg, it's yours.
Right now, we do have more chimps than we've ever had here at the sanctuary. 31 chimps, and they're divided into three different groups. I love all the chimps, but I do have a special place in my heart for what we call the infant group. Now, they're a bunch of misfits and babies that have really become a great family. It all began with four chimps. Zhao, the alpha male, Cozy, who's the slightly crazy uncle, and then the two infants, Sally and Zena. In the last 2 years, we've watched this little family expand to 12 members, and that includes a new adult male, Zach. Now, Zhao's still the alpha male, but let's face it, at 60 years old, he's pretty much ready for retirement. And Zach has recently been challenging him for leadership. It's probably only a matter of time before Zach takes over as the alpha male. Today might just be a pivotal point in the Zach-Zhao relationship. Zach might just overthrow Zhao with the introduction of the new camp. After following the signs of the last couple of weeks, we've been seeing Zhao back off to the extent where he's not even having breakfast with the rest of the group anymore. Whatever happens between Zach and Zhao won't happen overnight, but it will be interesting to watch. As if moving into a new enclosure isn't exciting enough.
It's dawn at the Sepalok Orangutan Rehabilitation Center. And all the rescued orphans are gearing up for another busy day at forest school. Sue's first job of the day is to get the toddlers up and out to their morning climbing session.
Come on in. We've got to teach them everything that their mother would have taught them, and more, because they're starting at a disadvantage. The training is almost like a boot camp.
Climb, climb.
Orangutans spend around 90% of their time in the trees, so they're built for climbing. But this essential life skill doesn't come automatically.
Come on.
Practice makes perfect. Twice a day, like clockwork, the young orphans are put through their paces.
Right.
They have to be trained to keep going. When they're asked to exercise, they do exercise. They build their muscles.
Every orphan orangutan starts his or her rehabilitation on the baby jungle gym.
Back, climb, climb.
Progressing to the intermediate ropes before scaling up to the more advanced rope system that adjoins the jungle. It can be up to 7 years before they're ready to return to the wild. Back in the nursery, the toddlers are still only around a third of the way into their training program.
It's important that there is somebody here to keep an eye on them because they do have falls. They're not expert climbers yet.
Go. Hey.
Come on.
While the toddlers hone their climbing skills, Today, one of Sepalok's newest arrivals is unaware he's about to take his first steps on the road to rehabilitation.
George can feed himself, he can scratch himself, but with only one foot, he cannot clean himself. His personal hygiene is left to others, and once a month, he is taken to the cleaners. George is an adult male. In the past, he has bitten a chunk out of Parony's ear and left her fingers with permanent nerve damage, so it takes a team effort to bathe him. Without this monthly ritual, he could well have died from all manner of diseases. A clean gibbon is a healthy gibbon, whether he likes it or not. The unusual sight of a gibbon being blow-dried is all part of a necessary service. For George, having one foot may be unfashionable, but he has the best hair in the gibbon world.
Bill and I were following about eight or so of the males.
Grooming in a path, we were way out to the west.
And we heard someone scream.
David and I, you know, kind of looked at one another and like, oh, excitement.
I briefly was thinking, why were they so upset? What's going on?
And we arrived on the scene. They actually attacked one of their own.
Brownface and Pinter and most, but not all of the Ngogo chimpanzees were attacking someone. And then I quickly realized they were attacking Grappelli and that he was in real trouble.
They beat him, kicked him. Oh.
Following the attack, which was brutal, Grappelli climbed a tree. There's no way another animal could survive that.